Hello friends, good evening. Welcome to One Academy. Let's crack NEET PG. I'm Dr. Shonali Chandra, and for today's session, we are going to be discussing about Mullerian anomalies. I've highlighted my reference code here, that is SHONALI. So if you take a plus subscription and you use this code, then you can avail a 10% discount on your subscription. I've also highlighted my Telegram link. So for any suggestions and queries, feel free to contact me on the link highlighted below. Unacademy is India's largest learning platform. The advantages of getting a plus subscription is that you will get access to unlimited live and recorded sessions from India's best educators. You'll get daily live classes where you can interact with your faculty, ask your doubts and queries and get them solved there and then. So it's like a live classroom experience. The courses which are there on the platform, they are structured, keeping in line with the latest NEET PG syllabus. There are also live tests and quizzes which will help you evaluate your performance as you go. And one subscription gives you unlimited access, so you can watch all the live sessions from all of the faculties on the platform. And even if you miss out on the live sessions, you can always go back and watch the recorded versions as well from the comfort of your own devices. Top educators are associated with the platform, like Dr. Nikita Nanwani for radiology, Dr. Mohammad Azam, Dr. Preeti Sharma, Dr. Devesh Mishra sir for pathology. And all 19 subjects are covered on the platform, and every now and then, long duration, comprehensive batch courses and concise crash courses, they keep getting launched. So you can check out the ongoing courses in the platform as well. As far as the subscription packages go, there is a package which can meet your needs and requirements. And depending upon that, you can choose the 3 months or 6 months or 12 months or even a 24 months subscription. Now, if you ask me, for those of you who are targeting the next year mid-year exams, they can take the 12-month subscription because it will give you ample time to go through all the sessions and also revise in the end. And it turns out to be more economical also in the longer run, ₹2,083 per month. And for those of you who are wanting a slower place of preparation, because of course you're in your third year and final years and are juggling hospital schedules and duties and classes and shifts and everything, so you can take the 24-month subscription. It turns out to be far more economical in the longer run, just ₹1,250 per month. And if you subscribe using my code, that is SHONALI, then you will get a 10% discount on your subscription, whatever package that you choose from. So coming back to the session at hand today, we're going to be talking about Mullerian anomalies. Brishti, hello. Didi Sen, hello. Rohan, hello. Welcome. Glad to see you all here again. So we have talked about the development of the female genital system yesterday. And now we know that the female genital structures, the uterus, the tubes, the cervix and part of the vagina, they develop from the Mullerian ducts, and part of the vagina develops from the urogenital sinus. And now we're going to focus upon in detail about the Mullerian anomalies, particularly, which I'm going to discuss today. Now, it's an important topic for your postgrad entrance exams. Direct one-liner questions are asked. Sometimes clinical-based questions are also asked. And the relevance of studying these Mullerian anomalies arises because, especially when we are going to deal with infertility or abortions, their reference of Mullerian anomalies does come there. So let us understand this whole topic in a nutshell together. So first, I will be talking about Mullerian agenesis, and then I will be talking about the rest of the Mullerian anomalies that are there, right? So we'll go step by step in that order. Okay, so what are the various Mullerian anomalies? Now, there are various classifications of Mullerian anomalies, detailed, extensive classifications. We don't have to go into the details of those extensive classifications, but what we need to understand is, in the simplest form, what are these various Mullerian anomalies? So broadly, the simplest classification is the one that is endorsed by WHO also, and I'm going to go through with that. So there's a class one, Mullerian anomalies, which deal with Mullerian agenesis, right? So the Mullerian ducts fails to develop, and the agenesis could be involving the entire Mullerian duct agenesis. So there can be absolutely no Mullerian duct development, or the Mullerian development is progressing in parts, right? So you can have a complete agenesis of the Mullerian duct, or you can have the agenesis of tubes, or agenesis of uterus, or agenesis of cervix separately as well. So that is all clubbed together under Mullerian agenesis, which can be partial or which can be complete. Then we have an anomaly where only one side of the Mullerian duct develops completely and the other side fails to develop. So that leads to an anomaly which is called as the unicorduate uterus. There can be a development of both the Mullerian ducts, but the Mullerian ducts fail to fuse in the center, and that can lead to a didelphous uterus, so double uterus and a double cervix. A bicornuate uterus, where the fusion of the Mullerian ducts has started or has progressed halfway through, and somewhere down the line it has stopped, that can result in a bicornuate uterus. Or there can be a septate uterus, where there is this failure of resolution of the septum, like we discussed yesterday. All right. And there can be an arcuate uterus also, which is more of a radiological abnormality. So I'll be talking about these in the subsequent sections of today's session. And finally, there is another class of Mullerian anomalies, which are the death-related changes, right? So these are the changes which I'm going to talk about in the subsequent session briefly. But now let me talk about the Mullerian agenesis first, because this presents a different set of clinical problems altogether. So this will be studied separately. And the unicornuate, didelphous, bicornuate, septate and arcuate uterus, these are clubbed together as the lateral fusion defects. These are clubbed together as the lateral fusion defects, and they have a different set of problems altogether associated with them, right? So let us start first talking about Mullerian agenesis. Now, what is Mullerian agenesis? Like I told you, that the uterus, the tubes, and the part of the vagina that is developing from the Mullerian duct, that is the upper one third of the vagina, that are going to be absent. So broadly, they say that the vagina is altogether absent. So the most importantly, the upper one third of the vagina is definitely going to be absent, right? The tubes are also absent, but sometimes, you know, please keep in mind that sometimes the lateral one third of the tube might be present as a remnant, may be present as a small remnant, right? So definitely the uterus altogether is definitely 100% absent in a case of Mullerian agenesis. And instead of a proper well-functioning vagina, you know, there's just a blind vaginal pouch, and that blind vaginal pouch is developing from the urogenital sinus. So that part of the vagina that develops from the urogenital sinus is going to be present, and it's just a blind vaginal pouch. So here inside, you know, in the pelvis of the female, we will find that there's no uterus, there are no tubes, lateral one third of the tube might be present as a remnant, the most of the vagina is also absent, and there is just nothing but a blind vaginal pouch. So there's an opening, vaginal opening, and when you go inside the vaginal opening, it's just a blind ending sac and pouch with nothing above it at all, right? So, and the depth of this blind vaginal pouch can vary. It could be significant, or it could be just as simple as just a very small dimple like structure there. So the depths of this blind vaginal pouch can vary. So this is what will happen in a Mullerian agenesis in the development of the female genital structure. The gonads, on the other hand, now this is my question to you guys, and you will answer now. What are the gonads in Mullerian agenesis? And this is the question that they ask in the PG entrance examination. Mullerian agenesis, uterus, tubes, vagina are more or less absent, right? What about the gonads? What are the gonads in Mullerian agenesis? Are they ovaries? Are they dysfunctional ovaries? Are they dysgenetic ovaries? Are they normal healthy ovaries? Or are they testes? What are these gonads and Mullerian in agenesis? Very good, Subhash. There is no problem with the development of the ovaries, because yesterday we talked about that the ovaries, they develop from the region of the genital ridge or the gonadal ridge, not from the Mullerian ducts. So the gonadal development is normal. So the gonads are normal healthy ovaries, all right? And what about the karyotype? Another important question: what is the karyotype in Mullerian agenesis? Is there a karyotypic abnormality in the female? Like, we know one karyotypic abnormality in a female, which is Turner syndrome. Is something like that happening here, or the karyotype is absolutely normal? What about the karyotype in Mullerian agenesis? The karyotype in Mullerian agenesis is going to be absolutely normal. So the karyotype is normal XX karyotype. So the female is absolutely normal otherwise, right? The gonads are also normal functioning ovaries, just that the Mullerian duct has failed to develop. So this is the pattern of presentation which occurs in Mullerian agenesis. Next question from me to you guys is, what about the breast development? Now I've provided you with this much information. Tell me, what about the breast development? Is the breast development going to be normal or abnormal, or is it going to be delayed? Are the breasts going to develop or not? And as you can see on the figure here in the inset, what am I trying to show you here? That the breast development is normal or delayed. Very good, Subhash. The breast development is going to be normal. So mind you, in childhood, you know, in childhood, when the puberty is not reached yet, you know, so the breasts are not developed. And after a young girl reaches puberty, her gonads become active, the ovaries become active, and they start synthesizing estrogen. And it is this estrogen which is responsible for the breast development during the time of puberty. And the gonads are normal functioning ovaries, and these gonads synthesize normal amounts of estrogen. So the woman is going to have a normal breast development. Her growth is also not going to be altered. She's going to grow at the normal rate. She's going to achieve a normal height. So no problem as far as that aspect of puberty is contained. Pubertal development is concerned, she's going to have normal breast development. She's going to have a normal height, right? The only problem that will arise is that she will have absence of menses, right? She will have absence of menses because she does not have any uterus to bleed at all, right? So the breast development is normal. Next question, what about the pubic hair development? What about the hair development in this area? What about the pubic and the axillary hair? What about these pubic and axillary hair? Are they going to be present or not? Pubic and axillary hair, are they there or are they absent? Yes. What about the pubic hair development in Mullerian agenesis? Normal, Shrigiri, very good. So like I told you, there is no other problem, right? So the pubic hair development is also going to be normal because this pubic hair are under androgen control. They are androgen dependent hair. And like we did in the first section of the gynae endocrinology, well, I talked about the menstrual cycle and everything. I told you that the ovaries also synthesize androgens. The adrenal glands also synthesize androgens. So the androgen production is not hampered in a woman with Mullerian agenesis. So that is why pubic hair development is also going to progress as normal. Now, one of the very important concerns with Mullerian agenesis is, like yesterday when we discussed the female genital tract development, I told you that there's a mesonephric duct which is coming from the primitive mesonephros, and around that, the lateral to that is the Mullerian duct or the paramesonephric duct which is developing. So these two ducts, they develop very closely together, and there where the development of the internal female genitalia is developing close by the renal system, right, the kidneys and the ureters, those, that system is also developing. So it has been seen that Mullerian agenesis can also be associated with coexistent renal tract anomalies, right? So this is a very important concern when we identify women with Mullerian agenesis. They could be harboring other renal tract anomalies as well. And there is a syndrome that is associated with this Mullerian agenesis. What is that syndrome called? What is that syndrome called which is associated with Mullerian agenesis? That syndrome is called as Mayer-Rokitansky-Custer-Hauser syndrome. Short form, it is called as the MRKH syndrome. Question asked in exams, another direct one-liner question that is asked in exams is, where is this syndrome seen and what are the constituents of this syndrome? So this MRKH syndrome consists of three anomalies, right? Mullerian agenesis. It will also involve renal agenesis, more commonly seen than horseshoe kidney. So both renal agenesis and horseshoe kidney can be seen. Any kind of renal abnormalities can be seen. But renal agenesis is more frequently associated with MRKH syndrome. And apart from that, there can be skeletal system abnormalities as well. And the skeletal system abnormalities which exist are hemivertebrae or scoliosis. Now, sometimes students get confused whether it is hemivertebrae or it is a scoliosis. Mind you, hemivertebrae means that part of the vertebra, half of the vertebra is developing and the other half is not developing. So when half of the vertebra develops, it has a physical manifestation of a curved spine. So it, in a nutshell, it means when I'm the same thing, right? So hemivertebrae will physically manifest as scoliosis, right? So hemivertebrae scoliosis will also be seen as a part of MRKH syndrome. So you need to remember these three important points. These three important associations which are seen in the MRKH syndrome, and question is asked on that. All right. Now, Srigiri, I will come to your question just a bit while. So what is the clinical presentation of a woman with Mullerian agenesis? Now, see, understand, Mullerian agenesis has happened during the intrauterine life of the female fetus, right? So during the time of intrauterine development, the female fetus has had no Mullerian duct development. Okay, she's ended up with no uterus, no tubes, no cervix, and part of the vagina is also not there. Now, when this newborn girl is born, when this newborn girl is born, the external genitalia is female only. Isn't it? The external genitalia is female only. She is a woman. The external genitalia is female only. So when this newborn girl is born, she is born and brought up as a female. She is also female for all practical purposes. The karyotype is XY. The gonads are normal ovaries. The problem will be that throughout childhood, we won't recognize her or we won't identify her. We will identify her when she will fail to have periods, right? So her clinical presentation will be at the time of puberty, not because she is not growing properly, not because she's not having normal breast development. Everything will happen fine, and the clinical presentation would be she'll be a 14, 15 or 16 year old young girl, but she will have failure of menstruation. She will have primary amenorrhea, absence of menses to begin with, right? So primary amenorrhea is the clinical presentation of a woman with Mullerian agenesis. That is when we will identify this particular woman with Mullerian agenesis. Now, Srigiri, you are asking that no uterus to bleed, where does the blood go? There is no blood there. There is no uterus. So even if the follicles are growing, even if the estrogen is getting produced, there is no target organ there. There is no uterus, no bleeding, nothing, right? No uterus, no building up of the endometrium, no menstrual shedding, right? So that is why primary amenorrhea, because she has no uterus to bleed, all right? Now, Think about it. Do you want to give this woman any medication or any treatment or anything that you can do to relieve her of the primary amenorrhea? Think about it. Tell me. Would we go for any treatment, any any surgery, anything at all to, you know, give her menstruation? Can we do that? Should we do that? Yes or no? Nothing can be done. Rightly said. What can be done now? She has no uterus. I cannot create a uterus for her to bleed. No matter. I mean, you know, her pubertal development is progressing fine. Her growth development, her breast development, her female sexual identity is progressing fine. So nothing needs to be done for this primary amenorrhea. Then what the hell is the problem with Mullerian agenesis? The problem with Mullerian agenesis, one problem is going to be difficulty in coitus. If she has just a dimple at the place where vagina could be, just has a blind vaginal pouch, maybe it's just a centimeter or 2 centimeters in depth, this woman in her lifetime, when she will get married, when she will get sexually active, she can have difficulty in coitus, right? So that is one problem here. Subhash rightly summarizing, hormonally normal but anatomically a problem, and anatomically also internal. Nothing on the external phenotype or external appearance of her is going to be anything less than a woman. Nothing of that sort is going to happen. So difficulty in coitus is going to be there. So intercourse can be problematic for her. And then later on, when she will want to have a biological child of her own, when she'll want to get pregnant and start a family, that is another problem. She has no uterus. She has no uterus, so she will have infertility. How can she get pregnant without a uterus? So she will be troubled with infertility in her lifetime. So these are the clinical presentations of a woman with Mullerian agenesis. And like I told you, if I talk about the clinical management, no hormonal support, nothing else is required. Nothing needs to be done for this primary amenorrhea. But yes, we can help her with her coitus. All right. So to facilitate intercourse, to facilitate coitus, what can be done is a vaginoplasty if required. Not that it will be needed for everybody, for all the women with Mullerian agenesis, but if she's having a difficulty in coitus, if there's a very small, shallow, blind vaginal pouch, then vaginoplasty, like creation of a vagina for her, you know, deepening of the existing vagina, these are plastic surgeries that are done there. So vaginoplasty is done if required. And when will this vaginoplasty be done? When do you think that this vaginoplasty should be done? Should it be done in a 14-year-old, the time that she is identified? Or do you want to do it much later? When do you want to do this vaginoplasty? When do you want to do this vaginoplasty? Think about it. When do you want to do this vaginoplasty? Do you want to do it immediately in a young 14, 15-year-old girl? Or you want to do it much later? Puberty is 14-15 only. Ideally, you should be doing this vaginoplasty. Ideally, we do this vaginoplasty when she decides to be sexually active. She could decide to be sexually active when she's 20 years old. She could decide much later. She could decide that now I'm going to marry and then I want to become sexually active. So whatever her requirements are, think about it, right? So vaginoplasty is not done immediately the day that she's identified, but it will be offered to her when she becomes sexually active. Whenever she chooses to become sexually active, this could or could not coincide with marriage. Okay, so whenever she chooses to become sexually active, that is the time that we do this vaginoplasty, right? So it's a plastic surgery. See, we've created a vagina and then we want this, and then we want the coitus to happen so that the vagina that we have created is functional, all right? So that is why we choose to do it when she becomes sexually active. The other thing is about infertility. Now, you'll have to answer me this question. I've given you all the details about the aspects of Mullerian agenesis. So answer now, can we do something about the infertility? Is it possible for this woman to have a biological child of her own? Is it possible for this woman to have a biological child of her own? Answer. Shrigiri, adoption. I'm saying adoption is a fairly good option. I don't deny that if she chooses to do so. But if she insists on having a biological child of her own, somebody own. If you adopt, then that is a different issue. Surrogacy, test tube, ART, nice, very good. Yes, surrogacy is an option, right? So she does not have a uterus, she can borrow a uterus from somebody else. She does have her own ovaries, so eggs can be extracted from her ovaries, and those eggs can be made to fertilize in the lab by the technique of in vitro fertilization. So we can use her partner's sperm and her eggs, fertilize them, get an embryo, and put that embryo in somebody else's uterus, right? So she can borrow a womb, she can borrow a uterus. So that is something that we call as surrogacy. So yes, IVF and surrogacy are management options for her infertility. So in a brief nutshell, this is what you need to know about Mullerian agenesis. All right, now moving on further, let's see a question here. There's a 16-year-old girl who is being evaluated for primary amenorrhea. The breast development is normal. The uterus is absent. There's a blind vaginal pouch and the gonads are ovaries. What investigation should be done next? Now, even if you have no idea about this question, first of all, think, what's your diagnosis which is coming to your mind right now? And then eliminate from the options below, what investigation should you be doing next? I have provided you with all the information that is required to answer this question. Margo, MRI, pelvis, Srigiri, CT scan, Srigiri, I think you are also thinking in the same direction in which Margo is thinking. But yes, MRI pelvis is better to rule out any coexistent renal tract anomalies. MRI is better for soft tissue delineation. So MRI pelvis, I will choose to do MRI pelvis because there is association with renal and urinary tract abnormalities, right? So to rule that out, we will have to perform an MRI pelvis, right? So yes, agreed. So MRI pelvis is the investigation that should be done next, right? Hormonal profile will show us nothing. Hormonal profile is going to be normal. The gonads are ovaries, right? So this is a case of Mullerian agenesis. This looks like a case of Mullerian agenesis, right? Hormonal profile is going to be normal. There is no need to go for a gonadal biopsy unnecessarily. The ultrasound is showing that the gonads are ovaries. The information has been provided to you in the question. Now answer another part of this question. If I ask you, how can we confirm the diagnosis? What test will we do to confirm the diagnosis? Okay, we know that the girl has primary amenorrhea, the breasts are normal, the uterus is absent, right? There's a blind vaginal pouch, the gonads are also determined to be ovaries on ultrasound. What test will you do to confirm the diagnosis? What is the definitive test? Or if they ask you, what is the definitive test to confirm the diagnosis? Subhash, I'm not asking you what is the definitive test for renal abnormalities, anything. So renal pyelography. Uja, gonadal biopsy, the ultrasound is already telling you that the gonads are ovaries. The final confirmative diagnosis will come by nobody's coming up at ultrasound. We've already seen on ultrasound that the gonads are ovaries. That is why this information is given to you, because most probably it has been seen on ultrasound that the gonads are ovaries. What test will you go for 100% confirmation of the diagnosis that it is not anything else and something that is definitely required? Karyotype. Karyotype will be done to confirm the diagnosis 100%, and the karyotype will be XX. So finally, we will confirm after doing karyotype, 100% definitive test to confirm is by karyotyping, right? So karyotyping will show that the karyotype is XX, and then we will confirm the diagnosis as Mullerian agenesis. This karyotype is normal. Yes, this karyotype is normal, but sometimes there have been other, anomalies where the karyotype could be abnormal, like it could be 45XO or 45XX/XO. So mosaic karyotypes are there, and this karyotype is required to differentiate it from another similar condition, which is called as androgen insensitivity syndrome, right? So I will be talking about that in the next session, in tomorrow's session, right? So we're going to talk about that, where Mullerian agenesis's differential diagnosis will be discussed, all right? So to 100% differentiate it from that condition, we have to go ahead with the karyotypic analysis, all right? Now, moving on further, let's talk about the defects of lateral fusion. What is this anomaly? Identify for me, please. What is this anomaly? Identify, figure-based, identify. What is this anomaly? Yes, anybody? Very good, Margo. This is didelphys uterus, right? So both the Mullerian ducts have developed separately. They have failed to fuse in the midline. That has resulted in a double uterine cavity, double uterus. It has also resulted in a double cervix, right? And it can be associated sometimes with a vertical vaginal septum. So if it can be associated with a vertical vaginal septum, you know, there can be a complete duplication of the genital tract. There can be a complete duplication of the genital tract. So there can be two vaginas as well. There can be two separate vaginas as well, but the didelphys uterus by definition is a double uterus and a double cervix. If it is associated with a vertical vaginal septum, then there can be complete duplication of the genital tract as well. So this is didelphys uterus. Let's see, identify this for me, please. What is this? What is this now? What is this defect now? Identify this defect. Very good, Margo. This is the bicornuate uterus. So the fusion of the Mullerian ducts, did happen, right? But what has happened? It has stopped somewhere. So what has happened is we have got two uterine cavities and we have got a single body of the cervix, and this is what we call as the bicornuate uterus. Now this separation can extend all the way down also, then it will be called as a complete bicornuate uterus. So this bicornuate uterus can be complete or incomplete depending upon how far down this separation is existing. So it can divide the whole of the uterine cavity and cervical cavity, then it will be called as a complete bicornuate uterus, or it can be partial. In this figure, it is partial, right? Identify this now. What is this? Identify this abnormality now. Very good, Subhash. This is a septate uterus. So in a septate uterus, the insides of the uterine cavity look the same. This is the two uterine cavities. Similarly, a single cervix. So from the inside, it looks the same. But there is a problem here. The how you have differentiated that this is septate and this is bicornuate. In bicornuate uterus, there is going to be a dip at the fundus. In the bicornuate uterus, there's going to be a dip at the fundus. And in a septate uterus, the fundus is going to be intact, right? So the fundus is going to be intact in case of a septate uterus, like we did yesterday, that after the fusion of the Mullerian ducts, right, there is a septum. When the Mullerian ducts, they fuse in the center, all right, these are the Mullerian ducts from both the sides, they have fused in the center. This septum needs to dissolve to form the uterine cavity. If there is failure of dissolution of the septum, it leads to septate uterus. So the fundus is intact in a septate uterus, whereas in bicornuate uterus, there is a dip at the fundus. What about this? What about this? In this abnormality, what can you see? That more or less the cavity of the uterus is normal. Can you see that the cavity is more or less normal? Cavity is normal. There's just a slight dip here at the fundus, very slight, maybe just a centimeter or so. This is, Rohan and Subhasha rightly saying, this is arcuate uterus. Srigiri, I will show you what unicornuate uterus is, alright? So this is an arcuate uterus. It's more or less a radiological abnormality because it is usually identified on radiological investigations like 3D, USG and MRI. There's just a slight dip at the fundus and there the cavity is more or less normal. So this is called as arcuate uterus. It is sometimes also called as a flat topped uterus. Flat topped uterus. Alright. So the fundus here, this is fundus here normally bulges. The fundus here normally bulges. In this case, the fundus is more or less flatter. So it is sometimes also called as the flat topped uterus. Right. So these are bicornuate, septate, arcuate uteruses. Now, what is unicornuate uterus, Srigiri? You've been answering unicornuate uterus for much of the time. So let us see here. This is a unicornuate uterus. Now, this uterus is developing, the tube and the uterus and the cervix is developing only one-sided paramesonephric duct. The other side is not developing at all. So this is a unicornuate uterus. And in this particular case, there is no development, absolutely no development of the other-sided Mullerian duct, right? Now, sometimes this unicornuate uterus can also have a rudimentary horn. This is also a unicornuate uterus. So A, completely unicornuate uterus. B, sometimes there can be this rudimentary horn. A very small rudimentary horn can be there, all right? And what will happen in this case is, in this case, this rudimentary horn might or might not have a functional endometrium. If this rudimentary horn has a functional endometrium, if this rudimentary horn has a functional endometrium, this rudimentary horn will also lead to buildup of endometrium during menses, and it will also lead to bleeding inside this rudimentary horn, and blood can collect here. Blood can collect here inside this horn, especially as you can see that this rudimentary horn is not connected to the rest of the uterine cavity. So in this case, in this particular case, there is functional endometrium and the horn is not connected, to the rest of the uterine cavity, and therefore blood can collect inside this rudimentary horn, and then it can cause pain, it can cause significant dysmenorrhea, especially unilateral dysmenorrhea. So they ask you this question, in which kind of uterine anomaly will you find painful menses, and in which kind you will find specifically one-sided or unilateral dysmenorrhea. So unilateral one-sided dysmenorrhea can be found in this unicornuate uterus. Okay, so remember that as well. Unilateral dysmenorrhea is not going to be seen with the other kind of Mullerian anomalies, but it's very specific to a unicornuate uterus, and to that kind of unicornuate uterus where there's a rudimentary horn with a functional endometrium, and if that rudimentary horn is not connected to the rest of the uterine cavity, blood will collect inside this and can lead to unilateral dysmenorrhea. Now there can be another situation of a unicornuate uterus, which I'll depict as C. Now in this case, there is again a rudimentary horn, but this time the rudimentary horn is connected to the rest of the uterine cavity. Now sometimes, now listen, it is not something that will happen frequently. It is not something that will happen most often. In any ways, the unicornuate uterus is not a common abnormality. But if there is a rudimentary horn with functional endometrium and it is connected to the rest of the uterine cavity, then sperms can ascend up and there can be a pregnancy also inside this rudimentary horn. Sometimes, rarely, this can happen. There can be an ectopic pregnancy in the rudimentary horn. There can be an ectopic pregnancy in this rudimentary horn. It is possible, okay, that there can be an ectopic pregnancy in this rudimentary horn, and that is called as a cornual pregnancy. All right, so these are some of the specific problems that can arise out of the unicornuate uterus. All right, so now we can move on further with the rest of the information that I want to provide you about Mullerian anomalies. Now, direct one-liner questions asked in exams, which of these anomalies is most commonly seen? Now, I'm talking about the lateral fusion defects. Mullerian agenesis is not a common abnormality. I'm talking about the lateral fusion defects, that is the septate, bicornuate, unicornuate, didelphys. These are the defects I'm talking about. So among these, which of them is the most commonly seen uterine anomaly? Yes, rightly said, Uja, it is the septate uterus which is most common. Srigiri, bicornuate comes after septate. Bicornuate comes after septate. Septate is the most common among them. So septate, then bicornuate, right? And the least common ones are didelphys, and the least common ones are the unicornuate. They are extremely, extremely uncommon. So septate and bicornuate are the most commonly seen. Which anomaly? All of these anomalies where there is inadequate development of the Mullerian duct, they are associated with urinary and renal abnormalities. But which anomaly has the maximum incidence of urinary tract anomalies? Among the lateral fusion defects, which anomaly has the maximum incidence of urinary renal anomalies? And the answer to this question is unicornuate uterus. It is the unicornuate uterus which has the maximum incidence of associated urinary or renal tract anomalies, about 40% incidence of renal tract anomalies seen with unicornuate uterus. All right, so this is again a one-line question that has been asked in your exams earlier also. And finally, talking about what are these DES-related changes? What are these diethylstilbesterol-related changes? Now, giving you this information that these changes are not frequently seen now. These were seen maybe, you know, somewhere in the 1940s and 1950s. There was this drug which was diethylstilbesterol, and it was given to women who are having an abortion to, you know, prevent an abortion as a treatment of abortion back in 1940s and 50s. And it was seen that women who had taken their drugs, their female fetuses went on to develop diethylstilbesterol related changes. Now, this drug has been out of use for maybe 50, 60 years now, and this drug has not been used because it has been significantly associated with, fetal genital tract abnormalities. So, this is something that is clinically less commonly seen these days, hardly ever seen, but still questions are asked in your exam. So I've included them in the presentation here. So there are a set of diethylstilbesterol related changes, which are vaginal adenosis, clear cell cancer of the vagina, cervical hoods and collars. The cervix would be distorted in appearance as if the cervix has a hood or a collar on top of it, a hypoplastic uterus and a T-shaped uterus. Now, they ask you often in exams, which is the most common DES-related change, which is the most specific DES-related change, which is the most common findings, right? So, such kind of questions they have asked in exams. So, overall, vaginal adenosis is the most common DES-related change overall, all right? And if they specifically ask you which is the most common finding in the uterus, then hypoplastic uterus is the most common finding in the uterus. So in the uterus, the most common finding is hypoplastic uterus. And the most specific finding is a T-shaped uterus, right? So the most specific finding is a T-shaped uterus. So these one-liner questions have also been asked in your NEET PG examinations. All right. And another very, very important thing to remember about DES-related changes, which abnormality question, diet question, which abnormality is not seen in DES-related changes? The answer is renal abnormalities. Renal abnormalities are not seen associated with the DES-related changes at all. So please remember this as well, that all the Mullerian anomalies, they have some or the other association with renal tract abnormalities. Except these DES-related changes, renal abnormalities are not seen in them. All right. So this is also another important question I wanted to emphasize upon. These are direct one-liner questions that have been asked in the exams. Another important question is, now tell me, what is the most common clinical presentation? So I have given you a set of specific clinical problems that can arise from a unicorn weight uterus. But thinking about that, the most common is a septate uterus and the second most common is a bicorn weight uterus. What do you think that these abnormalities will result in? What is the most common clinical presentation of these anomalies? And when they ask most common clinical presentation, obviously they are referring to the common abnormalities, that is the bicornuate and the septate uterus. So what is the most common clinical presentation? Niharika, amenorrhea, there is a uterus. Why will there be amenorrhea? There is a uterus, there are ovaries. So there is not a problem of amenorrhea. Sometimes there can be an excessive menstrual bleeding because there are two uterine cavities, you know. So there can be excessive menstrual bleeding. There can be painful periods. So those can be there. But what is the most common clinical presentation? What is the most problematic clinical presentation which will arise out of these anomalies? Margo abortion, C.R. Chaudhary recurrent abortion, Margo multiple pregnancy. No, Margo, not multiple pregnancy. Multiple pregnancy is almost entirely separate. So I will try to show you in this diagram here why it will lead to abortions. Can you see here that this area, I'll use another pen, wait. Can you see here? Now this area here, which is this cavity bulging into the uterine cavity, or this septum here, all right, in a bicornuate, in a septate uterus, this has less vascularity. Understand that the septum is nothing but fibrous tissue. It has less vascularity. It has consists of fibrous tissue. So if a pregnancy tries to implant in this location, unfortunately, if a pregnancy tries to implant on the fundus or here somewhere, you know, the pregnancy cannot grow properly because this area is scarred, it is fibrotic, it has less vascular supply. If a placenta is trying to develop at the location of the septum or at the location of this area, the placenta does not develop properly and the pregnancy can abort because of that reason. There is also lesser area for the pregnancy to grow. As far as a normal uterine cavity is concerned, where there is more space, in the bicornuate and septate uterus, there is less space for the baby to grow. So that also affects the growth of the fetus. It also can lead to abortions sometimes because of that constricted space. And secondly, there can be associated abnormalities of the cervix. The cervix could be weak. There can be associated cervical incompetence, and that is why there can be abortions. And very, very rightly said, it will lead to recurrent abortions. Abortions back to back, one after the another, recurring, right? So the most common presentation of the anomalies in this situation is recurrent pregnancy loss. Recurrent pregnancy loss. And in which trimester? Another question. First trimester or second trimester? In which trimester? First trimester or second trimester? most commonly in the second trimester, right? So most common clinical presentation is recurrent pregnancy loss, and that too in the second trimester most commonly. But if they ask you, can an anomaly cause a first trimester abortion? Usually they cause second trimester. But can an anomaly cause an abortion in the first trimester? And if so, which anomaly can cause a first trimester abortion? It is a septate uterus which can cause a first trimester abortion. Even a septate uterus is going to more likely cause a second trimester abortion. Please don't say that septate uterus, most common clinical presentation, first trimester abortion. No, I'm not saying that. What I'm saying is that septate uterus is one anomaly which can cause a first trimester abortion also. All right. And which anomaly can contribute to infertility? Now, Uja, you were saying infertility as a clinical presentation. Usually these abnormalities do not cause infertility, but if there is one anomaly which can contribute to infertility, and that is a septate uterus. All right. So what will happen is that there is an early pregnancy which is trying to implant at the septum, unfortunately for that pregnancy, and the septum is all fibrosis and there is no implantation that occurs. So implantation failure can happen. So this infertility in septate uterus can be because of implantation failure. Implantation ho hi nahi pa raha hai, right? So that is one reason why septate uterus can contribute to infertility. Bicornuate and other anomalies, they are not going to lead to infertility. Okay. And if they ask you which anomaly is the most problematic, which anomaly is the most problematic? Mind you feel that didelphous uterus, there are two uteruses, oh God, unicornuate uterus, there's a single small uterus, and you can think of maybe that there is this, okay, so you can think of a bicornuate uterus or a didelphous uterus, because anatomically they look very abnormal, right? Septate look fine. They said, oh, there's a small septum only, what is the problem? The most problematic anomaly is the septate uterus. If we feel that it is nothing but a small septum, that's not it. This septate uterus can cause first trimester abortion also. It can contribute to infertility also. Most commonly, it will lead to second trimester abortions. The most problematic anomaly, septate uterus. Unicornuate with a horn, Uja, wo problem karne ke liye, it has to be first present. It is so rare. It is so rare that it usually is not considered most problematic, right? So septate uterus is the most problematic anomaly here, and unicornuate with a horn is again very, very rare. Moreover, that horn has to have functional endometrium to create problems, again a rare phenomena, right? So anomaly which is most problematic is also a septate uterus. Now, best reproductive outcome is seen with which anomaly? Now, you should be able to answer this question. Best reproductive outcome, something that the anomaly which creates no problems at all most of the times. RQ8, Rohan, very good, because the cavity is more or less normal. So RQ8, very good. If RQ8 is not in the option, didelphous. Has the best reproductive outcome if RQ8 is not in the option. Didelphous is very, very rare. See, you know what? I have in my entire career so far, have seen one case of didelphous uterus, and I'll tell you how I identified it, okay? The woman had absolutely no problem. No menstrual problem, no abnormal bleeding, nothing. No problem at all. She came to me with discharge per vaginam. That was her complaint. Okay, pelvic infection, discharge per vaginam. I put in a speculum inside and I see two cervices. That is how I picked up in my career one case of didelphous uterus in the 7-8 years of my working. Didelphous uterus, by identifying two separate cervices the moment I put in a speculum inside her vagina. She had absolutely no problem. She even had a child. She even had one child. She conceived, she delivered, no problem at all, right? So most of the times, these didelphous uteruses are incidentally identified, if at all. First of all, they're extremely rare, okay? So they're incidentally identified and they create no problem, mind you. They might even not lead to recurrent pregnancy loss or anything. Each of the separate horns that they have developed, they can harbor a pregnancy absolutely fine. So the best reproductive outcome is seen with arcuate. If that's not in the option, then your answer is didelphous uterus. Okay, and other pregnancy complications can also be there, like intrauterine growth retardation, right? There is less space for the baby to grow. There is can be a preterm labor also, again, because of the uterus being having less space. The uterus can get irritated and it can lead to preterm labor contractions. If there is a placenta which has formed over the septum, that placenta's vascularity is compromised and that placenta can separate prematurely, leading to antepartum hemorrhage. And somebody in the chat did mention malpresentation. CR Chaudhary, you mentioned malpresentations, very rightly said. Malpresentations are also common with these anomalies. Like, for example, if there is a septate uterus, right? If there is a septate uterus here and there is a baby here, then the baby might align itself like this. So or in a transverse lie or in a breech presentation, because the space inside the uterine cavity is limited. So malpresentations can also happen as another part of pregnancy related complications associated with these lateral fusion defects, with these set of Mullerian anomalies, right? So when do we tend to identify uterine anomalies? Most of the times we tend to identify uterine anomalies when a woman comes with the clinical presentation of recurrent pregnancy loss, or when we are evaluating a woman with infertility, and we tend to identify a uterine anomaly because maybe we are doing some or the other test, like hysterosalpingography is being done to evaluate for tubal patency, or now is the time when she's undergoing an ultrasound for some or the other reason, maybe because she's having recurrent pregnancy loss or infertility. And under this evaluation regime, we happen to find these uterine anomalies. And the role of HSG, mind you, is that it can only suggest an anomaly, all right? It is not useful at all in diagnosing the type of anomaly. So this is a normal hysterosalpingography picture, right? So you can see here that a cannula is being introduced into the cervix. We instill a radio opaque dye through that cannula into the cervix. The dye is going to move into the uterus and it is going to come out of the tubes, and we're going to take an x-ray film, and this opacity radio opaque dye can be seen filling the cervix and filling the uterus, and then it is seen coming out of the tubes also. So this is a normal hysterosalpingography picture. All right. Now, what if I show you this? What is this? Is this bicornuate or is this septate? There's some problem, right? The dye is going into the cervix. Fine. There's a single cervix. But then it is now going two sides. So this is a bicornuate or a septate? Can anybody tell me? Or if I show you this, what is this? This is a bicornuate or this is a septate? What is this? Septate. So you are saying A is septate. You are saying A is septate and B is bicornuate. 100% so? Possibly so? Looks like so? Yes. Probably so. Right? So Rohan is saying BA is bicornuate, B is septate. Now, I'll just clarify this for you. If you're having your doubts, Rohan, I don't blame you for it. I will just say that HSG can only suggest an anomaly. So after HSG, you would say probably bicornuate, probably septate. If you have a doubt, it's fair doubt, because HSG do not tell us much, right? So A, if I say it could be bicornuate, it could be septate, I don't know 100% for sure, but likely septate, if I say no, choose, damn it, choose, whether it is septate or bicornuate, by looking at this HSC film, I can say it can be both. But if I have to say no, choose, then say septate, because the distance between the horns is less than 4 centimeter and the angle between the horns is acute. Okay, so the angle between the horns is acute angle and the distance between the horns is less than 4 centimeters, then you can say that it is likely septate. And B is likely bicornuate. B is likely bicornuate when the angle between the horns is, when the distance between the horns is more than 4 centimeter and the angle between the horns is an obtuse angle. Alright, so that will say that it is likely bicornuate, but I don't know for sure. Like, you guys got confused. It is very, very logical that one can get confused on an HSG film, right? So the definitive identification of septate and bicornuate can be made by doing an investigation of choice, and the investigation of choice is going to be either a 3D ultrasound or an MRI. If you have to choose one, we will say MRI. If you have to choose one, we will say MRI, not 3D USG. However, in routine clinical practice, mind you, more and more of us and the latest recommendations, we are moving towards 3D USG because 3D USG is much, much cheaper as compared to MRI, and 3D USG is as good as MRI in diagnosing Mullerian abnormalities, if not better. But yes, if they ask you in exams to choose what is the investigation of MRI, investigation of choice, and both options are provided to you, go for MRI. If MRI is not in the option, look for 3D USG in the question, all right? So for the clinical aspect of it all, I can also tell you that yes, most of us are currently identifying Mullerian anomalies based on 3D USG. It's cheaper. It is becoming more and more widely available these days. So wherever available, we are choosing 3D USG in clinical practice to identify these anomalies, all right? But yes, MRI should be chosen as the investigation of choice. If in the question, they ask you direct question, what is the investigation of choice for Mullerian anomalies? MRI, 3D USG, or any other investigation, choose MRI on top of 3D USG, all right? So MRI can give you a very good delineation of the fundus of the uterus. So in HSG film, what was the problem? In HSG films, what was the problem? The problem was we were not able to see the fundus of the uterus. We were seeing the insides of the uterine cavity. Now with MRI or with 3D USG, we can clearly see the fundus of the uterus. Tell me, what do you think is this abnormality? Is it septate or is it bicornuate? Is it septate or is it bicornuate? Focus on the arrows. Focus on the arrows. There are two uterine cavities. Okay. The whatever partition is there is extending all the way into the cervix, but there is a single cervical body. Can you see this outline here? And we can see this white arrow. The fundus is intact. And there is your septum here. So this is a septate uterus on MRI. So this is how MRI or 3D USG would also is going to help. These are MRI pictures. These are MRI pictures. Okay. What is this? What is this? Very clearly, look how beautifully and clearly we can see that this is a single cervix, two uterine cavities. This is, what is this? Bicornuate. Very good. This is bicornuate because there is a dip at the fundus here. We can see the dip at the fundus here. So this is bicornuate uterus on MRI. What is this? Uja, this is didelphys. Uja, this is didelphys. There is one uterus here with one cervical body like this and a separate uterus here. So this one here is likely a didelphys uterus. Okay. This one here is a likely a didelphys uterus. And please do not forget that the two, please do not forget my story. The Didelphys uterus diagnosis can be clinched by seeing two services on per speculum examination. That will be your first clinching point. Nothing as easier as that. A physical examination, you two services. All right. So these two services on per speculum examination is also going to clinch your diagnosis of Didelphys uterus. You go ahead with an MRI or a 3D USG to confirm, and there is your diagnosis made of Didelphys uterus. All right. So this is how MRI or 3D USG can help us diagnose for certainty. So you can analyze yourself that these are far more superior to HSG in making the diagnosis. But if they ask you in exams and they have asked this question, what is the gold standard investigation? If at all. However, I told you that the MRI can clearly delineate between the fundus and can clearly make the diagnosis. But even if you have a diagnosis, even if you have a doubt, let's say on MRI, then what is the gold standard investigation to differentiate between a septate and a bicornuate uterus? Srigiri, I'll come to your question after we complete this. What is the gold standard investigation? The gold standard investigation would be go inside the abdomen and look, and go inside the uterine cavity and look. So the gold standard investigation is going to be a hysteroscopy plus a laparoscopy. Mind you, not hysteroscopy alone. Do not answer hysteroscopy alone. If you do hysteroscopy alone, you put a scope inside the cervix and you are going in and looking at, one way you go, one way you see one cavity, the other way you see other cavity, you see a septum in between, you will see the same appearance on hysteroscopy in a septate or a bicornuate uterus. The insides of the uterus will look the same. You have to go for a simultaneous laparoscopy. So it has to be a hysteroscopy plus laparoscopy together, and on laparoscopy you can clearly visualize this dip at the fundus. This is the uterus. You can clearly visualize this dip at the fundus. And if this dip is seen, in this case, it is a bicornuate uterus. Okay. And if there is no dip at the fundus is intact, it will be a septate uterus. So the gold standard investigation to differentiate between septate and bicornuate uterus is hysteroscopy plus laparoscopy, not hysteroscopy alone. Srigiri, you wanted to know how abortion occurs in septate uterus as there's space. So even though there is space, the septum itself is very less, septum itself is less vascular, isn't it? So if the pregnancy is trying to implant on the septum, then it can lead to abortions. Or the septum can extend all the way down till the cervix. If there is this kind of septate uterus, where the septum is extending all the way down into the cervix, then there is some weakness inherent in the cervix also. So there can be associated cervical incompetence also. So whether or not septate uterus will cause abortion or not will depend upon how thick the septum is, how small the septum is, and so on and so forth. Right? Now, what is the treatment? Now, the last part of the session, what is the treatment? So, for the treatment of these anomalies, please keep in mind that surgical correction is done only if the woman is symptomatic, period. All right. Incidentally diagnosed anomalies, nothing doing, no treatment. Only if the woman is symptomatic. Symptomatic meaning if she is having recurrent abortions. Only if she is having recurrent abortions, only if she is having associated infertility, and that too after treating the other causes or after ruling out the other causes of infertility, after ruling out the other potential causes of infertility, will we go for surgical correction in a woman with these anomalies. All right. And what is the surgical correction for septate uterus? Can anybody tell me how should we remove the septum? We have to take out the septum. What is the best possible way of taking out the septum? hysteroscopic septum resection. Hysteroscopic septum resection, put a scope inside, right? Rohan Kamal unification operation is going to come at a later point when probably we are not able to hysteroscopically resect the septum because it is so damn thick. But in most of the circumstances, small septum, partial septum, thin septum, they can be easily resected by hysteroscopic septum resection. Jab septum andar hai, to bahar se why we want to go for any other difficult and complicated surgeries? Let's try the easier option first. Hysteroscopic septum resection. Introduce a hysteroscope inside. We have instruments like the resectoscope which will cut and burn and coagulate the septum inside, and we will resect this septum out. Ideally, this should be done under laparoscopic guidance. So surgery for septate uterus is hysteroscopic septum resection. Alright, under circumstances when the septum is too thick or too big, maybe then we consider unification procedures, but most of the times this should suffice and this is your treatment of choice. The unification surgeries per procedures, Rohan, that you're talking about are surgeries for bicornuate uterus. In bicornuate uterus, we cannot go for septum resection. There you have to do these unification operations that you're talking about, which are called as metroplasty, right? Metroplasty. So I'll just give you a brief, not that you have to know it in detail, but look at this bicornuate uterus. Look at this bicornuate uterus and these edges here, these ends here are incised with the scalpel. So you get this, it is opened up like this and then you sew it back. So you've opened it and then you have stitched it back. Anterior, posterior, you have stitched it back like this. This is a unification procedure of metroplasty. So you can understand this is technically more difficult. You are putting multiple sutures on the uterus, right? You're opening up the uterine cavity and everything. So these are reserved for very thick septum, septate uterus, or in cases of bicornuate uterus. Now, you also need for the PG exams the names of these metroplasties, not the details, but just the names. One of the commonly done ones is the Strassmann's metroplasty. We have Jones metroplasty and we have the Tompkins procedures. Okay, so these are the procedures with some or the other modification that are done for, these are all metroplasties with one or the other, some subtle modifications here and there. So these are the metroplasties which are done for bicornuate uteruses. All right, now questions that have been asked in the past. What is the most important indication for surgical correction of bicornuate uterus? Is it infertility? Is it dysmenorrhea? Is it menorrhagia? Or is it habitual abortion? What is the most important indication? Dysmenorrhea can be caused by bicornuate uterus. I don't disagree, but unlikely. But if there is dysmenorrhea, you can treat dysmenorrhea with painkillers. Yeah. Why will you need to go for this unification dam surgery for correcting dysmenorrhea? Menorrhagia can be controlled with drugs also. Then why to go ahead with a surgical, with an extensive surgical correction like metroplasty? Infertility, bicornuate uterus will not give rise to infertility. Any, if at all, infertility is seen with the Mullerian normies, it's with septate uterus. So usually bicornuate uterus will not cause infertility, but habitual abortion, yes. Recurrent habitual abortion is a previous name which was given for recurrent pregnancy loss. So if there is recurrent pregnancy loss, all of you are rightly saying it can lead to it needs treatment and needs surgical correction. All right, next question. While evaluating a woman for recurrent second trimester abortions, the diagnosis of bicornuate uterus was made on 3D USG. You explain the woman the need for doing an MRI abdomen and pelvis because there is an increased risk of congenital anomalies of which system? Skeletal, urinary, GIT or CNS? Pretty straightforward direct question, but given in a form of a clinical presentation. So you have identified or diagnosed bicornuate uterus on 3D USG, but you still want to get ahead and get an MRI done. Why? Because you want to rule out any coexistent urinary anomalies. Very good, everybody. Uja and Shrigiri. Second, a woman with recurrent second trimester abortions is diagnosed with septate uterus on 3D USG. What is the management? Laparoscopy plus hysteroscopy, hysteroscopy, laparoscopic chromoperturbation, or hysterosalpingography. What do you want to do? Or let me add another option here. Okay, yes, I can see that all of you are answering correctly. Laparoscopy plus hysteroscopy. Why? Because it can be what? You can treat at the same time. You can treat at the same time. So you will can treat at the same time if you perform a laparoscopy and a hysteroscopy, right? Very good. So that is important here. Next question. A woman was being evaluated for primary infertility. Look at it. The clinical profile has now changed. A woman was being evaluated for primary infertility. Her menstrual cycles are regular with normal flow and dysmenorrhea. The pelvic examination is normal. HSG was done for tubal patency and the result is shown in the figure. What is the best step in the management? Now you'll have to think a little here. What is the best step in the management? Should I go for an MRI pelvis or a 3D USG? Or I should go for a hysteroscopy? Or I should go for a hysteroscopy plus laparoscopy? What should be done next? What should be the best step in the management? Uja is saying A, Rohan and Shrigiri are saying C. Now, I agree with Rohan and Shrigiri here that there is that hysteroscopy plus laparoscopy should be done, because now this could be septate or this could be bicornuate, I don't know. But most likely, because she is suffering from primary infertility, I would still say that it looks likely to be a septate uterus, right? The other important point here is that she has primary infertility. So let's go ahead with the gold standard test. This is the gold standard test, first of all, to differentiate between septate and bicornuate. Secondly, if I go for a hysteroscopy lab, laparoscopy, and in any case I'm suspecting a septate uterus more likely, I can, you know, treat at the same time, treat at the same sitting, right? I can treat at the same sitting. Also, she has primary infertility, so other abdominal causes of infertility can be looked into. She has dysmenorrhea, maybe she has genital tuberculosis, maybe she has endometriosis, so that can also be found out on laparoscopy. So we can evaluate for other causes also, evaluate for other causes of infertility also, if we go ahead and do a laparoscopy and hysteroscopy. So why, you know, go through an expensive MRI pelvis, and why go through a 3D USG? Why not? In fact, they're asking you the best step. So the best step in this circumstance would be to go for a hysteroscopy and laparoscopy. A, it is the gold standard test for differentiation, right? B, you can treat it at the same sitting, and you can also evaluate for other causes of infertility. Uja, to rule out uterine anomalies, I agree with you there also that uterine anomalies are a concern there. But let us make the diagnosis first, right? Let us make the diagnosis first, whether it is septate or bicornuate. So here, the clinical profile of the woman tells us that she has primary infertility and dysmenorrhea, and that is her main problem. She has come with the complaint of infertility. So you have to give her a treatment which will be in line with treating her infertility as well. So with hysteroscopy, laparoscopy, you will be able to come to a diagnosis also. If you find a septate uterus, you will be able to treat in the same sitting also. And simultaneously, you will be also able to evaluate for other potential causes of infertility like endometriosis and genital tuberculosis, right? So that is why I will choose this hysteroscopy and laparoscopy here as the best step in the management, right? even if I do an expensive 10,000 rupee MRI pelvis, and in that, even if the diagnosis is confirmed there, or if it is not confirmed there, doesn't matter. Now, any case for infertility, this woman has to undergo a hysteroscopy, laparoscopy for evaluation of other causes. So that's why in this particular case, we're going to choose hysteroscopy plus laparoscopy. So the choice of investigation that is offered will also depend upon the clinical profile of the woman. Now, what is she presenting with, right? So for example, if this particular woman, if the same case the woman had recurrent abortions as the complaint, right? Then I don't want to do a hysteroscopy laparoscopy because I don't want to evaluate for infertility or anything. Then I might go ahead and do a 3D USG and MRI pelvis as discussed in the previous section, right, where it was being confirmed on 3D USG. Now the management was hysteroscopy and laparoscopy. So the treatment or the investigation that you offer will also depend upon the clinical profile of the woman. All right, clear now? Any more questions regarding this topic, you can ask me and put it on the chat and I'll look it up. And the other important thing that I want to tell you here, guys, is tomorrow, for tomorrow's session on YouTube at 4 p.m., I will be talking about development of sex and the XY females. A very, very interesting topic, a very, very conceptual topic. I'll be talking about androgen insensitivity syndrome and Swyer syndrome in detail. And we will be talking about the development of sex to begin with. This is going to be the session for tomorrow on YouTube. Today at 8 p.m. tonight, on the Unacademy platform, I'm talking about postpartum hemorrhage, genital tract trauma and uterine inversion. So you can join me there as well. And I'm launching a capsule course on high risk pregnancy, which starts on 21st August. It is a 9-day course. And we will talk about all the high aspects of high risk pregnancy in that. So again, the timing is 8 p.m. starting on 21st August, so you can check that out on the Unacademy platform as well. All right, so I will bid you goodbye. Have a great day and subscribe to the platform. You can use my code SHONALI and get a 10% discount on your subscription. Feel free to contact me on the Telegram link with any queries and doubts and suggestions as well. And see you tomorrow. Tomorrow is going to be an interesting session on development of sex, androgen insensitivity syndrome and Swyer syndrome. We will be talking how it happens that sometimes people who are genetically determined to be males, that is XY, turn out to be instead to be females, and then what does it lead to in their lifetime. All right, so we're going to talk about that tomorrow.